And now it is my pleasure to officially introduce John Simonson. John Simonson is a Kansas City author and lover of the local past, especially what he calls street-level history. Stories of overlooked places, forgotten events, and everyday lives. He's written for numerous publications and organizations and, since 2008, for his own local history blog titled Paris of the Plains, which became the basis and title for his first book published in 2010 by the History Press. His second book, Kansas City, 1940, published in 2013, makes use of dozens of tax assessment photos taken that year by WPA workers to tell a larger story about our very own Kansas City. The subject of his most recent book, which if you did not pick it up in the lobby yet, will be on sale after our program, is what he's going to be addressing tonight. So now it is with great enthusiasm, please help me in welcoming John Simonson to the stage.
Thanks. Thank you very much for coming. It's a great crowd. I had a bad cold last week, and I'm better, but I don't think my voice has caught up with me yet, so please bear with me on that. I've worked with Ryan Mabee, who's going to be here Thursday, I think, with the next program on Prohibition. We've done some Prohibition things together, or some things about Kansas City and its past together before. He makes a wonderful bee's knees, by the way, so I recommend it. If you can make that program, it'll be great. I think it's so cool that we're able to do this during the anniversary week of the start of Prohibition. It's the 16th, I believe, which is in a couple of days, and you know, journalists are always enthusiastic about doing anniversary stories. They like to revisit the past that way. And I've always, on my blog, trying to do the same thing, post a story about the past on the same date that it happened. I think it's another way of thinking about the past and bringing the past into the present. The book that I've done, actually all three books I've done, I've tried to do something similar. I'm a big fan of places, and so if you've ever walked down the street and seen an old building or something and wondered what had happened in that place before, you get the idea of where I come from when I do these. I'm always thinking about some aspect of some old place and trying to find a story that goes with it to bring to the front. So that's what we've done with all the books, but especially with this one too. We're really focused on buildings that still exist that had some story to tell about Prohibition. I mentioned in the introduction to the book that the book is really not about Prohibition writ large. It's not about the unintended consequences of Prohibition, like organized crime or the jazz music that came out of there. It's not about the Pendergast machine per se, although all those things are mentioned in the book. It's really just about the specific elements of what happened in Kansas City during that time, because I thought that was something that I hadn't seen enough of, so I wanted to investigate. I really spend a lot of time in research reading old newspapers, sometimes cover to cover, a daily newspaper, sometimes a week's worth, a month's worth, whatever it takes. And I always tell people that's the closest I've ever gotten to actual time travel. So I recommend it if you can find an old newspaper. The library has them on file, online for you to read. But even just a hard copy, it's a wonderful way to actually go back in the past. And I think it adds a layer of meaning to the present. So what we're going to do tonight, the book really doesn't talk much about what happened before Prohibition, leading up to Prohibition. But I'm going to detour from that just a little bit tonight and talk some about some of the things that did lead up to Prohibition, especially as they relate to Kansas City, and things apropos to the building we're in now and the war that it commemorates, because there was a relationship between World War I and Prohibition that we can talk about. And then I'll talk a little bit about the things that you'll find in the book, and then some about what happened after repeal in the 30s, which is really the period that we're thinking about when we talk about the wide open days of Kansas City. If there's any time, I might read a little passage from the book, but there'll be some time at the end for questions, as Camille said. And by the way, thank you so much to Camille and to Kimberly for setting this all up. I really appreciate the work that they do. All right, so with that all said, let's plunge right in. Two, what led up to some of the Prohibition activities here in Kansas City? Alcohol has always been a part of American life from the beginning. In part, because its quality was often superior to water back in the day. Alcohol abuse has always been with us as well. By 1830, it's said that the annual per capita consumption was 7 gallons, if you can imagine that. And stories abounded of lost wages, family strife, etc., attributed to alcohol overindulgence. So the temperance movement came into being around 1840, but actual prohibition, which was the legislation outlawing the sale and manufacture of alcohol, came soon after that. Maine, as you can see, was the first state to enact prohibition in 1851. And as you can see, Kansas was the second, although that came some years later. 1874 was the year that the Women's Christian Temperance Union was established, along with groups like the Anti-Saloon League, helped influence similar efforts in other states throughout the 19th and the earlier part of the 20th century. Women, in fact, became a driving force, and the suffrage movement arose at the same time. In Kansas City, the WCTU was led by this lady. Her name was Fanny Taylor. One of her quotes, many quotes, before Prohibition started, went as such: "We will not be satisfied until we have changed not only the laws, but the attitude of the world toward liquor." She was tireless. Even after repeal, she lived to be 94 years old into the 1950s and was still sponsoring programs in the 50s with titles like Building for Total Abstinence Through Legislation, Health, and Good Morals. If you can imagine that being part of 1950s culture. At the same time, as the second decade of the 20th century began, Kansas City church leaders were rising up against the city's culture of vice, vice being a euphemism for prostitution at the time, which was closely associated with saloons and drinking. They protested the city's plans to create a segregated district called the Vice District in town, which, as you can see, was planned for the area around the city market today. Which also happened to house the city hall, the county courthouse, the police department, and other official places. So one of the biggest targets of protest was this place, the Jefferson Hotel at 6th and Wyandotte, a location that doesn't exist anymore because of the freeway. The Jefferson Hotel opened in 1910. And in its short life, became quite infamous. It was owned by a guy named T.J. Pendergast. And he had his Jefferson Democratic Club headquarters in this building at the time. It was also home to the most popular cabaret being a saloon with musical entertainment in town. It developed a rough reputation as a place to find trouble. And when the U.S. entered World War I, and soldiers began training in the area, the Army surveyed possible trouble spots and identified the city's saloons and especially the Jefferson Hotel. So the government had made it illegal to sell alcohol to servicemen after the country entered the First World War. This was part of the Selective Service law. And for a time, all saloons were banned within a half mile of military encampments, which effectively closed almost all the downtown saloons because there were soldiers housed at armories and temporarily in hotels and whatnot. So any group of soldiers could be called an encampment. Well, that was not sitting well with a lot of powers that be, so eventually it was made the permanent camps, within a half mile of the permanent camps, like Fort Leavenworth, Fort Funston out at Junction City, that sort of thing. So the booze was still being sold to soldiers illegally all around town. So it became patriotic to advocate prohibition. And, you know, for instance, to the ire of brewers, most of whom were Germans, the case was made that grain, which could help the war effort, was being wasted in making alcohol. In 1918, Congress sent an agriculture bill to President Wilson that included a wartime prohibition of alcohol's manufacture and sale to last until the Army was demobilized. It began on July 1st, 1919, six full months before full-blown prohibition began. And as in other cities, Kansas Cityans took the opportunity to stock up. But Congress had already sent the 18th Amendment to the states in December 1917, and it was ratified on January 16th, 1919. So full prohibition would begin 1 year from that date. The Kansas City Star was sure it would be the end of booze. And prohibition supporters set their eyes on bigger things. So to some of us, it looked pretty dark. So as I said, this is my third book for the History Press. And as I said, we're focusing on places, actual locations around town. In this case, more than 50 surviving structures, both commercial and residential, that tell stories about prohibition here. Here we're looking down Main Street towards downtown in the period that we're talking about. So prohibition lasted from 1920 to 1933, but if you count President Wilson's wartime prohibition, as well as the weeks it took for Missouri to enact liquor laws after repeal, then we're talking about liquor being mostly illegal from the middle of 1919 to the early part of 1934. So like me, you may have heard or read something like Tom Pendergast ensured that prohibition didn't exist in Kansas City. In other words, this was supposedly some sort of fantasy land for booze and vice where no one was ever convicted of breaking the prohibition laws. That's just not true. Kansas City did have bootleggers and speakeasies and all forms of vice. We did have corrupt cops and politicians who helped make it all possible. And we had many moralizing reformers trying to clean it all up. But so did virtually every other city of size in the country. Kansas City's version of prohibition was not unusual. It was easy to get a drink in Kansas City. Speakeasies were abundant. And this next series of slides I'll show you are some of the pictures from the book that are of existing buildings that were speakeasies one time or another. You may have patronized them more recently as places that are still restaurants or bars or something. I'll just flip through these as I'm talking. Any place where a bartender kept a pint of corn liquor in his back pocket could be called a speakeasy. Many were drug stores with soda fountains. There were so-called soft drink parlors that legally could serve nothing harder than near beer, which was something with less than 0.5% alcohol. Some were in private homes in otherwise quiet neighborhoods. The cocktail party didn't really exist until Prohibition. Some were in cafes in downtown neighborhoods. Some were more secretive than others. Even the Plaza. And then there were some speakeasies called roadhouses out in the countryside. Does anybody recognize this building? Over in Fairway, Kansas, the Shawnee Indian Mission. This was called a chicken dinner farm. It was a roadhouse with gambling and jazz bands and private rooms. Briefly, in the summer of 1921, that's what happened to the Shawnee Indian Mission. The Kansas legislature had failed that previous spring to protect the mission with official historic status. This is what it looked like in 1920s. So it became available for rent, which a guy named Aaron Jack Koppelman did. Koppelman had been notorious in the pages of the Kansas City Star for running a cigar store / gambling joint at 12th and Grand downtown. And that June, the Star sent a reporter to the new roadhouse over in Kansas to see what was going on there. The place was raided, and Koppelman was convicted in Kansas of violating the prohibition laws. And he was serving a 4-month sentence when he became ill and was sent to the tuberculosis hospital over in Leeds. So the backstory of this is that Jack Koppelman was a war hero. And the story was he was fighting at the Battle of the Meuse-Argonne and was injured. He was wounded. And so he was sent to the hospital at the front lines. And while he was being treated there, bandaged up, he heard the story that his captain from the battle was missing and presumed dead. So he got up off his cot and went back to the front lines, found his captain wounded, and dragged him back to safety. So for this, he was feted as a hero. That particular part of the story was how, when he returned to his gambling cigar store at 12th and Grand and was raided by the police for the gambling, which was illegal at the time, of course, and brought into court, the judge totally berated the policeman for bringing him in because he was a war hero. Well, the Kansas City Star, which was a moralizing newspaper at the time, and very pro-prohibition, didn't take to this very well. And some people think that's how this story came about in the first place, about the Shawnee Indian Mission Roadhouse. Well, as Koppelman was recuperating, I should mention that on the last day of the war, he was gassed. You know, the day before the armistice, he was gassed. And this is how he ended up with tuberculosis and ended up in the hospital. So while he was in recuperating at the hospital, his birthday occurred, and he remembered that he hadn't had a party for quite a while. So he asked the members of the speakeasy gambling community in Kansas City, the cabaret owners and whatnot, to get a party together and bring it to the hospital for all the inmates there. So that's what they did. This was 1922. And Jack was in and out of the hospital over the rest of his life. But every year they had this party, same group of people. Would throw a party. They'd bring, you know, the bands that were playing in the speakeasies and the other entertainers and food and drink and whatnot. And they did this every year. Jack died in 1949, and this is an example of how the perception of some of these people who were vilified during Prohibition were sort of honored as time went by. This was from the Star as well in 1949, but he was considered a hero and everything else had been forgotten. It's interesting that one of his friends who helped him throw this party every year was a guy named Landon Laird, who was actually, I think, with the Kansas City Times, but he wrote a column called About Town for many, many years, starting in the early 30s until he retired, I think, in the 70s. He was one of the people that, after Jack died, kept this party going and into the 1960s. An example of how these things changed for these people, and it was true of speakeasy owners, bootleggers, many different types of gamblers and people who later ran, you know, they may have run a speakeasy during Prohibition, later they ran a popular restaurant well into the 50s and 60s. Maybe some of you are too young to remember some of them. Eddie's Supper Club downtown, Pusateri's Steakhouse, the original Majestic Steakhouse at 31st and Holmes, I believe. Lots of those places were run by former speakeasy owners and bootleggers. So, those were where you were drinking. As to what you were drinking, you never quite knew exactly what it was. Let's be thankful for Tomstown tonight. Sometimes it was the real thing, because real bonded liquor did exist, either from before Prohibition started or shipped in from other places like Canada or from places offshore in rum-running boats. This particular stuff that you're looking at was some Cuban liquor that came into town hidden behind sacks of chicken feed on boxcars from Biloxi, Mississippi. Or it was sold legally by prescription in drugstores. And there was lots of abuse in that system. But eventually, bootleggers discovered it was easier and cheaper to make it themselves, either by distilling, and this is from a big warehouse operation in the West Bottoms on St. Louis Avenue, where they had 1,000-gallon still working, or by converting industrial alcohol found in cleaning solvents, perfumes, etc., into something drinkable, by removing the poisons the government put in so no one would drink it. And of course, then they would add flavorings and colors, put them in bottles with counterfeit labels and counterfeit tax stamps, and sell it as the real thing. Or it was not so drinkable. Because it was illegal, there were no government regulations controlling quality, of course. And so some of it proved deadly poisonous. At one point, the police chief warned that most of the booze being sold in Kansas City was hair tonic with the blindness boiled out. For most of Prohibition, the recognized king of the bootleggers was this guy. His name was Frank DeMaio, Chi-Chi DeMaio. He had started early by shipping in the real thing, like many bootleggers, but later discovered the benefits of making it himself. He actually sort of pioneered a method of using a standard oil product called Stanilax, which was a laxative, to cause the poisonous elements of industrial alcohol to rise to the top during the process, which allowed it to be skimmed off. And he bought a huge amount of Stanilax. But eventually the law came down. Police and federal agents raided. Every so often the Star would declare the lid had been closed, but it never stayed closed for long. Bootleggers, large and small, did time in jail or prison. Frank DeMaio was the most successful and evasive, but even he did 2 years in federal prison. But of course, liquor still flowed in Kansas City, either down the throats of drinkers or down the sewers to the Missouri River after raids by law enforcement. The movies that we were watching before the program started showed some great examples of how they got rid of stuff. Sometimes people here in town bypassed the sewers altogether and took it right to the ASB bridge where it was thrown, along with the guns and gambling equipment and other stuff they received in police raids. This was done for years and years, before Prohibition, after Prohibition. So just imagine what might be down underneath the ASB bridge right now. Of course, the 1920s was a period of growth in Kansas City. Lots of construction and development, including many of the icons you see in today's downtown skyline. By 1929, the city had 60 buildings over 10 stories tall. And as the country's 19th largest city, it had the 8th tallest skyline. City fathers were into promoting the place nationally, as they did for the 1928 Republican National Convention, which gave us Herbert Hoover. The law and order crowd worked hard to ensure this would be an alcohol-free convention. Alas, it was not to be. The other big national event during the decade was when the American Legion brought its convention to town in 1921 for the dedication of the site for the new war memorial, here shown in an early rendition, which was never built as such. The Star, of course, made it clear that visitors would be protected from evil influence and professional criminals. There was a big parade, and the Allied military leaders attended. The Union Station was all decked out. The Legion member in charge of decorating the station for the week was a former captain in Battery D of the 129th Field Artillery, named Harry Truman. So at this point, Harry was a small businessman downtown. This is 12th Street looking east from the intersection of Baltimore Avenue. The old Journal Post newspaper described the neighborhood as representing leisure, recreation, entertainment, where hotels, theaters, clubs, and specialty shops predominate. It was where the biggest and best hotels were, including one on each corner at 12th and Baltimore. So right here on the right, this is the Mühlbach, which still stands. Just across from that is the Dixon, which is gone. That's one Kansas City place now. Opposite that on the left is the Baltimore, Hotel Baltimore, which was the Grand Old Lady Hotel at that time. And then closest to us on the left is the Hotel Glennon. So David McCullough's biography of Truman includes this passage. Conventioneers poured in and out of the Mühlbach. In the Dixon Hotel across the street were two gambling houses. Prostitutes worked the neighborhood day or night, salesmen, secretaries, shoppers from out of town. Nearly everybody seemed to have money to spend. The five-story Glennon on our left was demolished in 1929 to make way for the Phillips, which we still have. And it was where, the Glennon was where Harry Truman's and Eddie Jacobson's men's furnishing store was. This is an ad from 1919 when it opened. And this is what it looked like on the street level inside the Glennon. So now we're looking back south along Baltimore at 11th Street. And the Hotel Baltimore is on the left with the awnings there. It was one of the headquarters hotels for the 50,000 soldiers, ex-soldiers, who were in town for the American Legion convention. And the scene of much revelry on the last night of the convention. Another of Truman's biographers described it this way. Women's negligees floated from the Mühlbach Hotel windows to the trolley wires in front of the haberdashery. And across the street, a stockyard steer ran from an elevator on an upper floor of the Baltimore Hotel. Harry was an active legionnaire and saw much of the craziness, though no one remembered him participating. He did participate in the main public event during the convention. Well, this was the headline the next day in the St. Louis newspaper about the party in the Hotel Baltimore lobby. And this was the one from the Kansas City Post, which is a competing newspaper here in town, to the Star, about the free flowing of booze and the cause of pandemonium, etc. And some additional details from that story. And City Bootleggers also supplying the white mule and moonshine to the men, liquor sold openly, etc., etc. Well, the Star, being the paper it was, said, no, there's nothing to see here, folks, just keep moving. An example of some of the double standards that took place, depending on the context of the situation that during Prohibition. Interesting story about Harry Truman during Prohibition. So about a year later, his store had to close. They didn't do enough business. But within months after that, the Pendergast machine had recruited him to run for county judge, which he did, and where he served for most of that decade. He split his time between the county courthouse in Independence and this one, which at that time was at Fifth and Oak, down in the city market district. Since it's long gone since. Right across the street from this building, also at Fifth and Oak, is this existing building. You may recognize it. It's right next to the Foo Frog restaurant. But back in Prohibition, it was also known as the Amo, a notorious Northside place, one of the most popular cabaret speakeasies in town. So Harry was obviously aware of his surroundings. And if you Google today, if you Google his drinking habits, you may come across a story about how he liked to have breakfast with a shot of bourbon. So about a block or two north of this place is this existing building, which today is a Vietnamese restaurant. But back in the teens and 20s, this was known as Tony's Bar. It was a soft drink saloon in Prohibition, run by a Sicilian immigrant named Tony Borelli. Tony did some time in state prison for selling liquor in the late 20s, and then when he returned after repeal, he opened a new place a block away at 5th and Cherry. He passed away unexpectedly in 1937 from an appendicitis attack, and his wife took over. Her name was Jenny, and for many years, she ran this place that was known as Jenny's Italian Restaurant. You may remember it because it only closed in the 90s. Very popular Italian place down there. So for the book, I talked to Tom Borelli, who ran Jenny's for many years. One of his favorite family stories about Prohibition was that Harry Truman liked to come into the original Tony's before work at the courthouse and have his morning shot of bourbon there. So Prohibition ended in 1933. Congress passed the 21st Amendment in February. Missouri ratified the amendment in August. And Utah made it official in December. President Roosevelt had already made 3.2% beer legal again. And this was the scene on 12th Street on April 7th, 1933, the day legal beer returned to Kansas City. In January 1934, Missouri legalized liquor by the drink in larger cities, leaving smaller towns to decide for themselves. Federal and state licenses were required. Closing time was midnight. Such were the limits to be crossed on the way to a wide-open town. In most cities, alcohol had long coexisted with gambling and prostitution and corrupt police. But most cities regained control after repeal. Kansas City's police force had long been run by the state, as it is today. In 1932, the Pendergast machine won a state Supreme Court ruling allowing home rule of the police department. The St. Louis Post-Dispatch took note of the situation here that year, 1934. That same year, 1934, the local nightclub scene came out of the closet and into the neon light. Clubs, clubs, and more clubs. The Chesterfield Club, basically 9th Street and McGee. So this was how a nightclub column in the Journal Post described what was going on at the Chesterfield Club. The type of entertainment in the Streets of Paris concession at the Chicago's World's Fair is featured at the lively Chesterfield. Translation, there are naked ladies here. The Chesterfield was known for its businessman's lunch, if you haven't heard about this place, where waitresses wearing cellophane aprons and nothing else were serving. And there was a card game or a craps game in the back room. So in 1934, we're still on that year. A Frenchman named Georges Valot toured the country doing research on alcohol consumption. Of course, this was after repeal. He told reporters his three booziest U.S. cities were Reno, New Orleans, and Kansas City. Beyond that, one stood out as wickedest town. I have seen the streets of Paris at their worst or best, but they are nothing like Kansas City, he said. If you want to have a good time, go to Kansas City. 4 years later, so 1938, a reporter from Omaha came to town at the height of the Pendergast machine's infamy and provided the quote you may have seen most often. If you want to see some sin, forget about Paris and go to Kansas City. This is the famous quote, but actually this guy had been beat to the punch by a syndicated columnist named Westbrook Pegler, who came to town the same week to write a series of accusatory columns about the Pendergast machine and its Tom's Town. He also invoked the naughty Paris thing. But my favorite line from this happens about halfway down here. He's talking about Kansas City being described as a trading post on the frontier. But he says, she's not a post at all, but a great city whose reputation has suffered from the inclusion in her name of Kansas. Which he says is a word signifying thin-lipped social bleakness, prohibition, and an aversion to the pleasures of others. So Pegler, this was 1938, Pegler comes back during World War II, about 5 or 6 years later, to reassess the situation. He writes, "Well, sir, you just wouldn't know the Paris of the Western Plains today." This was after Pendergast had served time in Leavenworth and the reform government had been voted in. So about a decade after this, we're talking the 50s now, excuse me, Capitol Records comes out with an album of Kansas City jazz from the heydays of the 30s. The illustration on the front, by the way, is a depiction of the Chesterfield Club. So they get to write the liner notes, a guy named John Cameron Swayze, you may remember him, sort of from NBC News fame and also the voice and face of Timex watches for a long time, takes a licking and keeps on ticking. So he was a reporter here in the 30s for the Journal Post and also for one of the radio stations. And he was reciting, he had covered things like the Union Station Massacre. He was reciting his experiences here, and he remembered that Westbrook Pegler called it the Paris of the Plains, which is how we got that nickname, how we became Plains Parisians. So, at this point, questions. I have lots of more specific stories we can talk about, but I thought maybe we should leave a chunk of time for this at the end.
Folks, you are welcome to come down to either side of the stage to a mic, and if you are unable, I will come to you. Just raise your hand really high.
Lots of great... well, I mean, you may have an idea about some legendary story in your mind that you want to bring up. There are lots of them about this time. But what we're really talking about when we talk about Paris of the Plains is the period after Prohibition, when, as I said, the state laws have been set up most places, and we had them in Missouri. But because the Pendergast machine was in total control at that time, including of the police department, it was a wide open town for all practical purposes for that whole period of the 1930s. Hi.
Hi. Mostly you talked about like downtown mm-hmm. Kansas City, and I was wondering how Westport like plays into all of that, or if it does at all.
Sure, yeah. Westport was like many other places, neighborhoods in town, full of little places that served liquor. So smaller... well, let's go back. Saloons were everywhere pre-Prohibition. So many of those saloons went out of business. Many of them stayed in business as soft drink saloons. They could sell any kind of soft drinks, near beer. And as I said, if the proprietor kept a pint of liquor in his back pocket or had some secret hiding place in the place, it was, for all practical purposes, a speakeasy. So those places were everywhere, and there were some in Westport. I had two or three in my list. I'm not sure all of them made the book, but the part of 39th Street closest to State Line that we call 39th Street now, where all the restaurants and bars are, had some. And as I said, they were dotted all over. 39th and Main was a big location for clubs, both during Prohibition and after. So yeah, they were everywhere.
There's a restaurant, Jimmy's Jigger, that's right on state line. Uh-huh. That supposedly took advantage of the state line with regard to police enforcement, where they would kind of shuffle things from Kansas to Missouri in terms of the gaming tables and the alcohol and that sort of thing. Were you able to come up with any stories on that?
Yeah, so I'm not sure that Jimmy's Jigger was, Jimmy's Jigger was there for sure, and I think it was maybe established as such in the early days of after repeal. The place you're thinking about was down on Southwest Boulevard. It was called the State Line Tavern, and it was right on the state line. Half of it was in Kansas, half of it was in Missouri. And so this kind of thing went on there, where if they were raided by police from one state or the other, they could just move all the gambling equipment or whatever was going on across the state line. That actually was, you know, where 31st Street comes down to Southwest Boulevard is where the state line is, actually. It's not further west than, but that's where it was, right there. And that actually became notorious later in 1950 as, you know, the last place that Charles Bonaggio and Charlie Gargatta were before they went back to their Democratic Club headquarters and were murdered. If you know anything about that story, it was part of the, Kansas City was a big location for organized crime even after Prohibition, and 1950 was the date when that happened, and the Senate opened a hearing on organized crime in Kansas City, or the hearing took place in Kansas City, and they interviewed many of those people that were active during Prohibition and beyond. During that, but yeah, that place existed. It just wasn't Jimmy's Jigger. It was down on the boulevard. Yeah.
For a lot of the reading and research you had to do for the book, was a lot of it just manually digging through old archives, or have organizations like the archives done any sort of like indexing to make your job doing that easier?
So I spent a lot of time at the downtown branch of the Kansas City Public Library. They had that wonderful collection, the Missouri Valley Special Collections, upstairs on the fifth floor. They have many files on Prohibition and related activities, nightclubs. So they have a lot of archived files specifically on that, which are helpful. They can lead you to primary documents like newspapers. I actually do spend more time with the daily newspaper. It's helpful because the Star is, and this wasn't true while I was researching this book, but it is now available in a searchable form through the Mid-Continent Public Library. And that's, you can search, you know, a word in the Star from way back until today. So, but what I was doing was a little more time consuming, and I had to look up things in a more difficult fashion. But yeah, the archives at the library, the archives in the state archives, there are a number of wonderful sources that have files that are a good place to start, and then you can kind of branch out from there.
This will be our last question.
I want to tell you how much I enjoyed your presentation first.
Thank you.
I have two, but they're both short. The first was, Mr. Copeland, what was his birthday if someone were to want to celebrate it now?
You know, I do have that. I'll have to look it up, though. I don't have it.
And the other is, I'm curious, the time frame when Pendergast and these fellows were in charge of also the police department and the lawmaking, what was the murder rate? I mean, just living in Kansas City in 2020 and having lived here all of my life, I'm very curious, what was it like then?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it was a period of high crime, especially as the Depression kind of overtook Prohibition, and people were having a difficult time surviving. But yeah, as far as murder rate goes, I don't know that I've seen a number for a particular year back then, but they were very concerned about a crime wave. And this is how the gangster movie became a thing in the early days of sound movies, especially, because it was quite on everybody's minds. It wasn't just Kansas City. It was happening many places. And, you know, people like Bonnie and Clyde and Pretty Boy Floyd, who some people believe was involved in the Union Station massacre, Dillinger, lots of these people kind of came up at the same time in the early 30s. And it was a thing. It was a serious thing in Kansas City. There were lots of stories about it being a place of crime, and all kinds of crime, not just murder, but violent crime, robberies. Yeah, so it was definitely a thing. I just haven't seen the kind of numbers that we see now, for sure.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Folks, John will be available in our lobby if you have additional questions, and he'll also be signing copies of his book, which are still for purchase. On behalf of the National World War I Museum and Memorial, let's have another round of applause for John Simonson.
Thank you.
Thank you.